What about raising hands in the dua, in the khutbah prayer?
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam wa rasulillah. The sunnah is not to raise the hands during the khutbah. The khatib makes the dua, and you listen to the dua and you say ameen, but it's never been confirmed in the sunnah that you should raise your hands during the khutbah. Not the khatib and not the one who's praying behind him. Barakallahu feek. Yes. The brother's asking about the reality that being the obsession that people have with social media, and the reality is that many of the people have ruined their lives, and become actually losers. One who spends that much time on social media is not somebody who's successful in life. It shows you that if you're somebody who is a loser, somebody who's not successful, don't take it harshly, this type of language of being a loser, but this is the reality. And tests have proven, some people, when they ask them how many hours a day they think they spend on social media, they say about 4 hours a day. But in reality, it's up to 8 to 10 hours a day for most people. It's become such an obsession that you'll find that the first thing that we do, wake up in the morning, is what? Even before we say Alhamdulillah, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us another chance in the dunya, we open our telephones. Okay, we go to sleep at night, not following sunnahs and not being with our families, but what? On the telephone. In the prayer, the first thing we do, we finish before we start the tasbih, is what? We take out the telephone. In the prayer, we put our hands on our pocket just so we can touch her, we can caress her, and let her know that soon we'll be back with her. This is the reality. It's become an obsession. Successful people in life don't use the telephone like this. Why did Steve Jobs and those who are in charge in Apple, why did they forbid their children from playing with the iPad? They give them like 15 minutes a day. Because they know what true knowledge and true success is in reading and educating oneself and bettering oneself in other ways. So the reality is that people have chosen to ruin their lives. And a lot of the stuff, it's idiotic. Especially sometimes you have, even some of the brothers, but you have the sisters who are really into the pictures of the food and what have you and all this, and Snapchat on things that are not beneficial. I'm gargling now, I'm doing this now. Who cares, Let's be real. Okay, I'm eating this food. Okay, if it's a special meal, even us sometimes, maybe if it's something very unique, Bismillah, we might take a picture of it. But I mean, your three meals a day and the snacks you have in between, it's nothing really special about it, honestly, So to waste one's time and to just be obsessed with all this, it's a big waste of time. And if you want to be successful, put a time limit for yourself. And maybe before you go to bed, and what happens, also, studies have proven it's very dangerous to sleep with the screen because it sends a message to your mind that it's not time to sleep. So you get very bad sleep, very negative sleep. It doesn't benefit the body. So for example, what I'll do sometimes is the telephone, I'll look at it, at all the messages before I go to sleep that I need to answer. And then turn it off. And I'll leave it outside of the bedroom. We go old school in the bedroom with the book. And it's beautiful. You benefit knowledge and it gives you a good sleep, a good rest. And even they say you shouldn't even have a television in your bedroom. That should be just a place for sleep. So all of these things are harmful for the body and they're ruining our lives. And a lot of times it's making us go away from that which is wajib. Even now when it comes to being a mother, to being a father, you'll find people at the dinner table on this. This should be forbidden. You should forbid this in your house. You should only have time for this. Is family time. It's very, very important. And then people, when they lose the family member, they say, wish we spent more time with him. Why? Because you're wasting your time on social media. So it's one of the big traps of shaitan that we've fallen into. And like the brother said, he said, I'm speaking about myself, also myself. And I'll tell you, I went through this. And they say, if you want to change habits, how many days does it take to change habits? 21 days, 21 days. In India, maybe it's 22, but in reverse, it's 21. The studies say it's 21 days, right? So to break a habit. So alhamdulillah, I remember I had one of the sheikhs that came over from the UK to our masjid in Ireland. And I said, you know what? I said, we keep talking about it. And people, I said, I'm going to do it today. I'm going to make my tawbah today. So I started leaving the telephone outside. And even sometimes I'll turn it off when I'm doing my work. How can you work and the telephone's on every time? What's up? Yeah, khalas, you have to turn it off for some time and focus. And this is what successful people do. You'll find that they're not the ones who have the telephones. Even some of them don't even have smartphones because it wastes so much time. They're beneficial. It's a two-edged sword though. You have to be able to be strong and to be able to benefit from it and what it benefits from. I have all the things. I have Snapchat. I have all this, but I'm not obsessed with it all the time. You know, and everything I do, here I am, there. It's a joke, and even sometimes even worse, it can get you into riya. You know, you'll find somebody's in sujood now. He's taking a picture of himself. A'udhu billah. You know, subhanallah. Yeah. Alaykum
salam. If we need to seek knowledge, what's the book should we start with in different disciplines?
The brother's asking about which books should we start with if we want to seek knowledge. It depends, obviously, if you speak Arabic or not. If you speak Arabic, you have a much wider selection in front of you. But if you're studying, for example, in the English language, any the main books of Tawheed, the Usul al-Thalatha, and then after that, the Qawaid al-Arba, the four principles, and then you're going to go into the Kitab al-Tawheed. And then after that, the Aqidah Wasatiyah. These are the main books, obviously, you need to study. After that, any At-Tahawiyah and what have you. Also, we have in the English language a very, very good series, which we actually study in the Islam University. And many people have it on their shelves, but they never read it, which is the series that Sheikh Omar al-Ashqar did about Aqidah, the Iman bil-Malaika, Iman bil-Allah, Iman bil-Malaika, and all of the different pillars of Iman. It's an amazing series, and we studied it in detail when I was in third year in the University of Medina, and it's something I would recommend that people read as well. Very good read, and it's available in the English language and in Urdu and other languages as well. Alhamdulillah, it's translated, so you can benefit from that work of Umar al-Ashqar. That's an Aqidah. A book that I would recommend starting with in Fiqh, Al-Mulakhas Al-Fiqhi, Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan. It's a very, very good book, and it's something even when I was in Medina, this is what I used as my foundation to understand Fiqh in the beginning. And then after that, obviously, when we studied Zad al-Mustaqni', the explanation, the sharh of Sheikh Saleh Fawzan, which I just saw now is translated. I don't know how good the translation is, but sometimes these big translations are not that good, but this one could be good, Allahu A'lam. But that's been translated now as well, the explanation of Sheikh Saleh Fawzan to Zad al-Mustaqni'. So that's also a very good book in fiqh. And Seerah, the best book to start with is, I believe, Sheikh Ali Salabi's book about Seerah, or Rahiq al-Makhtoum. You could read both of them, both amazing books in Seerah, alhamdulillah, both translated into the English language. And Tafsir, alhamdulillah, we have Tafsir ibn Kathir, which is the abridged version, so it makes it easy to read, and alhamdulillah, that's beneficial. Along with the Tafsir, I would recommend as well, if you go, for example, to Quran.com, they have different things. If you look on the right-hand side, different things you can, and you can, they have the word-for-word tafsir. So if you go through the word-for-word tafsir and understand what they mean, each word means, and then you go to Tafsir ibn Kathir after that, it'll be very beneficial, inshallah ta'ala. Alhamdulillah. Yes, brother.
Assalamu
alaikum.
Being a Muslim, are we allowed to practice things like meditation or things like creative visualization? Basically, things which fall under the science of positive psychology.
What is creative what?
Creative visualization.
What does that mean? How do you do it?
It's to think positively or to imagine a bright future or to imagine a specific X amount of money in your bank account. Things like...
Bismillah, that's good stuff, man.
Alhamdulillah. I mean, basically, things which...
Creative visualization, I think there's no problem with that, you know, to think about the future. And obviously we know we're supposed to, even from the hadith of Rasulullah SAW, we're supposed to prepare for our dunya and for our future as if we're going to live forever, inshallah ta'ala, and to strive for the akhirah like we're going to die tomorrow. This is the teachings that we know from Islam, that we need to strive to be the best we can be in our worldly affairs. So if you're, you know, want to be, and a lot of times, you know, people don't realize how being negative, how bad it is on what's happening in our life, on the outcome of where we are in our life. Always be positive. They can come now, we can say a lot of negative things, but there's a lot of positive too. A lot of times you sit with people, they say, you know, I remember I was discussing with somebody, they said, "Akhi, Kuwait has this and this." I said, "What about the positive things here?" I said, "Also has this and this and this and this and this." He's like, "Yeah, you got a good point there." Huh? So it's actually the positive is much better, alhamdulillah. So we have a lot of good. So always want to build, and when you think about the positive, it helps you build. When you think about the negative, it always takes you back. I remember I was in the airport the other day, and I was doing some work. And we were in Sudan, and for some reason the AC wasn't on. There is an AC in there, but maybe, bismillah, what was happening, maybe it wasn't working, you know. I don't know. But anyways, there was a young guy next to me, he kept complaining about this, complaining about that, complaining about this. and I'm doing my work, and I'm hot. I'm Irish, you know. You're Sudanese. It's not. I'm hotter than you. Definitely, this is again guaranteed. But nonetheless, what can I do? I can't change it. You know, I can't go turn on the AC myself. So we have to have supper, you know. And I'm trying to concentrate on work, and he's just complaining about this, complaining about this, and that. And I was about to just like, I wanted to hit him with my laptop, astaghfirullah, and just like, istaqila, taqila, yaqi. Because, and it, what can we do to change the situation? Just negative, it pulls you back. Always negative vibes is very, very bad. So to have positive thoughts about the future, it's something that can be, you know, that's what helps you build. Negativity always pulls you back. The issue of meditation, we don't have meditation in Islam. We have dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have a type of meditation which is not a meditation that is not doing anything like the Buddhists do or something like that. We said, no, you might to sit back and to reflect, which is the muhasaba, to reflect on your actions, to reflect on this. There's something even the muhasaba, that's similar to what you're talking about, the positive thinking as well. Because we have, the scholars talk about the issue of muhasaba, holding yourself to account. When you think about what your deeds. And here, once again, when you hold yourself to account, you focus on the positive that you've done to build on it. And you look at the negative things that you've done and you try to erase them. This is what we're supposed to do in Islam. The problem is people start to look at things like you have the Buddhist, you have the meditation, and even when you look at a lot of the successful people in life, they have these different types of ibadah because the human soul needs these things. So people want to do these type of things. People, even Muslims now, are looking in that route. Why? Because they're not benefiting from what we have, the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ala bi dhikrillahi tatma'innul qulub. That through the remembrance of Allah, the hearts find assurance. This is a promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But our problem is, we don't know how to make dhikr. This is the problem. It's not just any, oh, first of all, what type of dhikr should you be making? Dhikr that's found in the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the best dhikr. And then how to make the dhikr. How do most people make the dhikr after, for example, after the salat? What? What is that? How does that affect you right now if you say it? It's a joke. It doesn't benefit you. Hopefully you'll get the ajr for your intention and trying to say the dhikr. But if you were to think about it, subhanallah. What does it mean? To glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah. You know, praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you think about the meanings. And you feel it inside. And you do it slowly. Not the machine gun dhikr. You know. It doesn't work like that. You're not going to benefit anything from it. So this is why people are looking for other solutions. Even though everything we have it in Islam. So this type of meditation, which is a type of ibadah, we need to stay away from it. And even if people are getting like things like yoga and things like this, we don't realize a lot of these things have they're built on acts of worship in the Hindus religion or in what the Hindus believe. So it's important that we stay away from these things and focus on benefiting from what we have, because we have everything in our religion. It's just to be able to benefit from it properly, inshallah ta'ala. It's to glorify, to exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah, you're glorifying and exalting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you see the beauty of the creation of Allah subhanallah, exalting Allah, glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's what it means. And even if you, even some of the ha, you feel it from inside, subhanallah, you feel it from inside. If you really reflect on the meanings and focus on it, you're going to find you're going to benefit it. And that's why Shaykh al-Islam, Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, what Ibn al-Qayyim mentioned, he said that he would sit, and he's somebody who's, and he look at the knowledge he had. And Shaykh al-Islam, he was specialized in each and every science of Islam. And so much so that even in the four madhabs, he was Hanbali. But he was so specialized in the Hanafi and Maliki and Shafi madhab, they say even more so than their own scholars. Very well based. Spent his life, he didn't even get married, he was so busy with seeking knowledge, subhanAllah. Not saying that's a good thing, but that's what happened with him, and that's what happened in his life. He would sit until mid-morning, as his student Ibn al-Qayyim said. He would sit in the masjid after he prayed the fajr until mid-morning, just making dhikr. And he turned to his student one day, Ibn al-Qayyim, and he said, "Hada ghidai." This is my nourishment, the nourishment for the soul. So this is what we're in need of. We have it, alhamdulillah, but we don't benefit from it, unfortunately.
Assalamualaikum.
Salam.
My question is pertaining to azam. We have been told when Muslim says azam, we should repeat it. It has big ajr.
The brother's asking about repeating the adhan, and we say what the muadhan says, except for when he says what? Hayya ala salah and hayya ala falah. What do we say? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. The brother asked al-fajr, there's an extra thing, which is As-salatu khayrun min an-nawm, then you say with him, As-salatu khayrun min an-nawm, just as he said. Because the hadith says, you say as the mu'adhin said, except for obviously when it comes to hayya al-salat and hayya al-falah.
Welcome,
salam. Naam. Now the brother is talking about the issue of the tafakkur, which is reflecting. And Imam Ibn Qayyim mentioned that a tafakkur is from the greatest ibadat. And as the brother said, it's one of the forgotten things. And so it goes back to your question again. When you think about things, and the issue of meditation, basically they want to think about nothing. And that's not what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to have tafakkur where we think about the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatness of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're talking about the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Himself and His beautiful names and attributes. When you do this, this is one of the greatest ways to increase the iman. That's why I always joke with our brothers here from the Gulf when they travel to the Western countries. What do they do? Where do they go? To the cities. Does it increase your iman to be in Paris or to be in London? When you go outside to these countries and you see the countryside and you see the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, absolutely amazing. And that when you really reflect on this, it increases your iman. So it's a good point that one of the things we need to focus on as well, not just with the dhikr, not just with the muhasibah, but also with the issue of the tafakkur, which is reflecting and thinking about the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His creation. Jazakallah khair.
Can you tell us more about how you come to Islam, or have you been a Muslim for your life?
Alhamdulillah. The brother was asking about how I came to Islam. And if you can type my name into YouTube, spelling it correctly, which is the challenge. But it should be on the poster, wherever it is, alhamdulillah. Which is with Abdurrahim, with a double E and a double R. Huh? Abdurrahim, double R, and then double E. And then McCarthy, if you type my name into YouTube, one of the first things that will come up is how I came to Islam. There's also one that was done in Arabic by Qatar TV, inshallah, but I don't know. It's not as easy to find, but the English one is easy to find. So that's available. You can see that because it would take a very long time for me to explain that. As for the future of Islam in the West, I see it being good, alhamdulillah. The Muslims are becoming stronger, and they're becoming stronger because they're starting to understand something that the first generation didn't understand. And the first generation, when they went there, they felt that they had to isolate themselves and not be part of society. Also, the first generation that went there, they were not really there. Their bodies were there, but their minds were back home. Everything was about, how can I build a house back home? And so they weren't really building in the community. But obviously you have now second and third generations who are there about establishing, and they're becoming positive members of the society. And they've realized that in order to integrate into society, you don't have to assimilate. You see what I'm saying? And you don't have to leave your deen. You can hold on to your deen and you can still be very strong and Muslim and a very strong member of society as well. And that's having a huge impact. And we see it a lot with a lot of our brothers who are doctors and engineers who have, you know, good positions. And even the brothers who are storekeepers and like this, and they're honest. It's having a good impact on the community, alhamdulillah. Being able to mix with the larger community and show a positive image of Islam. So that's having a good impact. And alhamdulillah, we have certain countries. Like we all see what's happening these days in Canada, the stances from the government there, mashallah, very, very good, where they are standing with Islam, standing with the Muslims to support them, to let you know freedom for all. So it's a very good thing with governments like this, that we can build things for the future, inshallah ta'ala, for the Muslims in the West. So I see it being a good thing. Obviously, there's a lot of challenges we're facing, no doubt about that. Even we heard yesterday about Austria talking about banning the niqab. And it's important that the Muslim governments, they should stand up against this, especially the governments where many of their citizens wear the niqab. This is something that's not acceptable for a government to come and ban the basic rights. And I remember, to be fair, that the Obama administration, when France banned the niqab, one of the best reactions to this, and people don't realize this, was from the White House. It was very beautiful what they said in defense of the niqab and the women wearing niqab, and how they said, we're totally against it. We're totally against this, and it's something that should be the right of the woman to wear how she wants to wear. And it was very, very good what they were saying. But once again, we always focus on the negative things. We don't focus on the positive. Allah mustan.
We're going to take the last two questions, inshallah.
Yep. We have three brothers, khalas. We'll take three questions, inshallah. What about the sisters? What happened to the poor sisters? You said you're going to send somebody to them. You never sent anybody to them, I think.
I think we have enough kids
Okay, so, yeah.
Sheikh, a lot of people from the Middle East end up immigrating to places like Australia or Canada. And people have an issue regarding the oath of citizenship. That there are some concerns regarding that being some elements of
shirk.
Can you comment on that?
I'll let you answer it. I was born American. I don't know why you became Swedish. Alhamdulillah. Yeah, the brothers, it's a good question about, you know, the oath you have to take when you take a citizenship in the West. Honestly, there was a meeting of several scholars when they discussed this issue. Is it permissible to take the citizenship from the West or not? And the majority of them said it's not permissible. However, many of them were citizens of the Gulf countries who live in a very good situation. And the reality, when you live in the West and you see the difficulties that the brothers are facing in their countries, and they can't get ahead and they can't get good jobs because of the nationality they have. And honestly, I'm not against anybody. If they can, somebody can hold on to the deen. The problem is, many people who come to the West and they leave things from their deen and they go far astray. This is the problem. But if somebody can hold on to his deen for himself and his family, I personally don't see a problem with taking the nationality. And then the issues that go against the deen, there's a lot of issues. Even you might find in some Muslim countries, there's issues that goes against the deen that you have to deal with. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows what's in the intention. So when you make this this oath, you take this oath, Allah knows what's in your intention, which is for you to better your situation and better situation for your children in the future. So I personally, like I said, from my experience, and seeing the, you know, what people have done with it and benefiting themselves in their future, I don't see any problem with that, inshallah. Allah knows best. There's two brothers here.
We had a question a very long time ago.
Then don't answer all of them, inshallah, because we promised to answer the two brothers here, inshallah. Go ahead, brother. Yeah.
I just want to ask about smoking, because yeah. Something wrong with my, I think there's something saying it's haram, some else saying
We explained last week in last week's session in detail about Q&A and the Q&A, week's Q&A session in detail about that and where this difference of opinion came from. We're not going to repeat it all now, but just to give a summary of what was said, that smoking nowadays, there's no real difference of opinion between the scholars, no real difference of opinion that it's haram. Why? Because of the harms that it has, something that kills you. Okay, look at the pictures they put on. I mean, that should be, and you don't need much more evidence than that. This is what this is smoking does to you. And I've lost even my own grandfather to smoking, which came back 10 years after he quit. Ended up getting the lung cancer from the smoking and came back to him. My father almost died from it. So it's something that you can see now, the ill effects. My own aunt, she died from lung cancer as well. So subhanAllah, you'll see that the effects that it has, it's clear that something is clearly haram when something harms you that way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbid us from throwing ourselves to the tahluka, for destroying ourselves, and no doubt we destroy ourselves when we smoke. Go ahead, brother.
Assalamu alaikum. We have one issue within our subcontinental, within Indian and Pakistani Muslims.
I support Pakistani cricket myself because they're a Muslim country. Bismillah. No, go ahead.
Mazhab or not following it. As you were speaking to one, or answering one of the questions you mentioned about Imam Ibn Taymiyyah being a Hanbali. Similarly, the house I've been brought up, we have been following Imam Shafi'i, but there are a lot of conflicts come, no, this is not allowed, or this is goes against the Sunnah. How do we, of course, first of all, face such kind of conflicts, and what's your opinion about this following of the Imam?
Yeah, the brother's asking about following one of the four Imams, the four Madhabs, and the question, and it's very easily answered. Somebody say, no, it's not permissible, we have to come with like a new athari way, a new way of fiqh. And the reality is, as we were discussing with one brother recently, when he said that we followed, for example, the opinion of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen and the Sheikh this, I said, okay, then what makes Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen's fiqh better than the fiqh of Imam Ahmed or Imam Shafi'i? What makes him more knowledgeable? Somebody said, oh, he came later, he looked and he understood. But and all throughout history, you have people like Imam Nawawi, like Sheikh Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, who also had good understanding, looked into all of the text. So the reality is, if you look through history, and this answers it clearly for you, find any imam who didn't come up studying a madhab. it's very rare. You have to really research to find someone. And then if you dig deep enough, you're going to find that originally he studied a madhab. Look at, for example, in the time we study, in the time we're in, Sheikh Mbaz, what's his madhab? Hanbali. No, he doesn't deny it. Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, what's his madhab? Hanbali. Sheikh Al-Albani, what's his madhab? Hanafi. Hey, brothers don't want to admit this. Sheikh Al-Albani is Hanafi, man. He studied the Hanafi madhab. That's his foundation. Yes, he ended up leaving things. A lot of them, when you get, and that's what happens. Once you get to a certain level, that's when you start to leave and start to look into other madhabs and other opinions. And you have different, that's Sheikh Mbaz, Uthaymeen, Al-Albani, kulhum, they did the same thing. Where they started on a madhab. So starting on a madhab, what happens, it makes it easy for you. The brothers asked the other night, they said, we want to take just from the first three generations without any madhab. These four imams, where they come from? Which generations they came from? The fourth and fifth generation, they came from the first three generations, alhamdulillah, so don't worry about that. And they said, we just take from the Quran and Sunnah and this. I said, go ahead. I said, I dare you to try it. Brothers, I said, I dare you to try it. There's no way, it's impossible. You have to go back to something the ulama have done. So what makes these madhabs so unique? And it's not, by the way, these four, there were some who were more knowledgeable than them. Imam al-Shafi'i, he said, كَانَ لَيْثْ أَفْقَهْ مِنْ مَالِكِ. Imam al-Layth ibn Sa'd, he was more knowledgeable than Malik. He had more fiqh than Malik. But he didn't have the students that Malik had. And that's why these four imams were successful, because of the students they had around, the team they had around, that saved their work. And what did they do? They took their opinions, what they understand of the Quran and Sunnah, and they based it on a way to make it easy for the people. So if you study, for example, we have in the Hanbali madhab, we'll study something just in the beginning, just to understand the ibarah, to understand the basic fiqh. The next level, we'll study the book a second time, and then we'll start to go through some of the evidence. Then the third time, we'll study a book, and we'll start to go through some differences of opinions. But what happens, and this is something from my own experience, and that's why now, even when I'm teaching now my fiqh, I used to teach like more Athari type fiqh. Now I'm teaching more of Hanbali type fiqh. Why? Because even myself, after all of these years, I get confused. I forget, because we're all over the place. The first issue we come into, we study in the Hanbali madhab, or if you're Maliki or Shafi, the same thing, which is how many categories are the water? How many categories are the water, ya ikhwan? It's the first issue in fiqh when you open the book of fiqh. Three. There's three categories of water. This is the Jamhur, the Maliki, Shafi, Hanbali madhab. The Hanafi madhab is what? Two. The strongest opinion is which madhab? It's the Hanafi madhab. If you look into the evidence, it's strong. That's why Sheikh Mbaz, Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah, before them Sheikh Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, all of them said that the correct madhab is the Hanafi madhab. If I'm opening up a book and I'm studying and somebody comes and says, no, actually this is a wrong opinion, and the correct opinion is this, and the evidence, the student gets lost. But if you make it very easy for them in the beginning and then start to spread out, once you have the foundation, that's the best way to do it, inshallah ta'ala. But what's meant, and this is why I'll end with this, people need to understand that the madhab, we have something which is, and we say, al-ghaya wal-wasila. Ghaya and wasila. What does a wasila mean? Wasila is the means to get from point A to point B. Ghaya, it's the objective, it's the main goal. My ghaya in this dunya is to what? That Allah is pleased with me and I get the Jannah. This is the ghaya. The wasila is what I have to do to get there. So when I study fiqh, what is the objective of me studying fiqh? To understand what? What Abu Hanifa said? What Ahmed said? What Shafi said? What Malik said? My objective is to understand what? What Allah said? What the Prophet ﷺ said? To understand the Quran and the Sunnah. So the madhab, it is a wasila. It's a means for me to understand the Quran and Sunnah. Once I start to learn new things, and what has happened in the Ummah, and this is why people are so against studying the madhab, is because people have made it into what? A ghaya, that this is it. And Imam Abu Hanifa or Malik or Shafi, or us, I won't listen to anything else. You know, some brothers, they don't raise their hand in the salat. Say, akhi, hadith is Sahih Bukhari. He said, no, I'm on this madhab. Another brother, I talked to him one time, and he was Maliki, and they said, we take new water for the, what do you call it? When you make wudu, when you wipe the head, they take new water for the ears. Sheikh, the Sunnah, the authentic hadith, is the same water that's on your hand you use for your ears. And the hadith you're using, it's da'if. And look at the major scholars of hadith. All of them said the hadith is da'if. He said, I don't care, I'm Maliki. Allahu Akbar. Come on, man. This is the problem. When you get into ta'assub and blind following. No, I studied the Maliki madhab. I have the foundation. Then if something comes to me which is more authentic. And some of the amazing thing is, all of the four imams, they say the same thing. That if you find something which goes against my statement, a hadith, then you leave my statement. As someone said, "Idrabi arz al-hayd," you throw it against the wall. different statements, all the same meaning, that you leave my statement and take that. So if you study fiqh like that, and you gradually work your way up, and you realize that it's not a ghaya, it's not the an objective is to understand what the imam says, but to understand the Quran and Sunnah, that's the correct way, and inshallah ta'ala, nothing wrong with that, inshallah ta'ala. There was another brother here, I think, and that's
last question.
Yeah, inshallah. No.
So about that, how can we feel? Does he have sign, or is there?
The brother's asking about this istikhara. Is there any type of sign? Allahu alam. I really don't know. I have to research some more into this because this question keeps coming up. I mean, I think it's just something that, you know, Allah makes that way easy for you. You know, it'll give you a certain feeling of that's the right thing to do. It'll give you some certainty when you do it, inshallah ta'ala, that you made the istikhara. But I don't know if they're like, you know, you're going to see this or that is going to happen. No, it's just, I think it's just something inside that you will feel inside that will guide you to that way that's the best way for you from those two things, inshallah ta'ala. And it's amazing dua if you reflect on the meanings. And then many people know the istikhara, they might be able to read it in Arabic. But if you go back and reflect on the meanings, it's really deep. It's amazing, the istikhara. Yeah, obviously the brother's asking if I remember is more of the Quran and knows more about the deen, will I be able to, you know, have more of a focus when it comes to, you know, when you're supplicating and knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The answer is obviously yes, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاء. The ones who fear Allah from His ibad, from His servants, are the ulama, the ones who have the knowledge. So the more knowledge you have of the deen, the closer you become to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more your yaqeen, your certainty increases, and the more your iman increases. And the more you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to the dua, when it comes to what you do, and subhanAllah, just knowing how to do something. When you know, and look at examples from the dunya. Now when you go, if you're going to go to study, for example, martial arts, the first few sessions, how does it feel? You feel out of place, you're a bit nervous, you're a bit scared, and you don't know what's going to happen. Especially if you study jiu-jitsu. Anybody done jiu-jitsu before? Because most dojos, what do? They have you, at the end, you spar at the end on the first night. And you go against a guy that might have a purple belt or a black belt, and you don't know what you're doing. And that happened to me my first time when the guy choked me out. And the place I trained, because I trained Japanese jiu-jitsu, so we wouldn't get choked out all the way. They let us go early, but then Brazilian, they, until the end, until you tap. I felt it for 2 weeks, but alhamdulillah. So the point is that you feel out of place. The same thing now in the deen. You just kind of go through it, you're timid, you don't know why you're doing it. But once you, subhanAllah, you implement and you act and you know why you're doing it, you have basira, you have understanding of why I'm doing these actions. It takes it to another level, your iman, you have certainty. Now, look for, who's been for hajj, mashallah? Who's been for Hajj? Allahu barak. And then may Allah bless all of you to go for Hajj soon, inshallah, the ones who haven't been. When you go for Hajj, or you've been for Umrah, and most people have been for Umrah, inshallah. If you've been for Umrah, when you don't know what you're doing, how do you feel when you're going around? You feel like a complete imbecile, you know. What am I supposed to do? I'm just watching other people do it, other people falling around, and what am I supposed to do? And you're going the wrong way, the right way, you don't know. But when you studied and you know how to make Umrah, you go in and you're ready, man. You put everybody else has the thing down, what? Underneath the shoulder from the beginning, which is against the sunnah. But you say, I know that's wrong. So you start, when you start the tawaf, and you're running there in the beginning, and then after that, you put it back on your shoulder, because you know, you're not supposed to, you have certainty when you're doing it, because you have the knowledge. And that takes your ibadah to an entire another level. And Allah knows best. Allahu a'lam wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammad wa jazakum Allah khairan.